Texas suit that was filed against actually pointing out some of these irregularities and, you know, et cetera, with a number of these other states. And of course, the individual behind that is Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton, who joins us via Skype. Good to see you, sir. Thank you so much for your time today.
Hey, great seeing you. Good to be on with you.
Of course. So you are getting a lot of heat for this lawsuit, and it's surprising to see how I think tribal everything is, because even amongst Republicans, there are Republicans that are criticizing you, saying that it's just a silly effort. And then, of course, you have critics on the left that are saying a lot more. And then you have some individuals who say, well, yes, this is the perfect forum to resolve this. Talk to me about what is the aim of this suit, because you're not looking to overturn the election. I mean, this is specifically looking at the seating of electors.
Yes. So, you know, it's interesting. It's what is Shakespeare, they protest too much. So if there was really nothing to this, even some of these Republicans who are protesting, why would they care? It's a lawsuit. And if it means nothing, it'll go nowhere. And why would they be out there complaining about it? So it is interesting how much interest this has from all kinds of people and all kinds of legitimate people. And yet, you know, supposedly this lawsuit doesn't mean anything. So our focus really is on the constitutional issue here, which is Texas defended our laws. We won 12 lawsuits related to mail-in ballots, signature verification. We had all kinds of challenges, and we fought to hold the genie in the bottle so that we didn't end up like Georgia. We didn't end up like Wisconsin, because we would have. They wanted to mail out millions of ballots just in Harris County. So our argument is, hey, the Constitution requires that the state legislature set the rules and parameters for federal elections. These states did that. Unfortunately, no one followed them. And the rules were changed by local officials around these states. They had different rules for different counties. And there's no way now that there was no signature verification, that we can know whether these 2.5 million ballots that were, you know, sent out and that were voted on in Pennsylvania, we'll never know whether they were legitimate or not, whether one of them was, or all of them, or none of them. So that's our issue.
Right. Yeah. And the argument that is being made by in the brief that you had filed was saying that, you know, this year you have these state legislatures that have the power to determine the manner of selecting these electors. There are those who are worried about the issue of federalism. And they say, well, shouldn't this, I mean, because states can determine the manner of selecting electors, and they can determine all of this. But your argument, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that, well, yes, but this is disenfranchising voters in other states, because, I mean, is there, do you think it's enough? Like, I think, what is it, in Pennsylvania, I think it was like an $80,000 vote difference between Trump and Biden. That's the argument in the brief as I read it, correct?
That's correct. So this idea that of federalism is either somebody that hadn't read the lawsuit or is misrepresenting it. I am a states' rights guy. I think you know that, Dana. I've filed, you know, so many lawsuits against Obama on states' rights. We've defended Trump administration on states' rights. We have focused on that issue since I've been in office. This is not about states' rights. This is about whether state law, they set their own state law. It was their right to do that, however they wanted to do it. Our argument is the Constitution requires that they follow that law, and no one did in these states, or very few people did.
Is the Supreme Court, and we're talking with Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton about the Texas suit, is the Supreme Court the only manner of addressing this issue? I go back, and again, I play a lawyer on radio. But I go back to that. There was a Senate race in New Hampshire. It was like 1974, and it was contested. And ultimately, they had the Senate determine this. I spoke with Andy McCarthy yesterday and asked him this question, and he says that the appeal should be made to Congress. So, what is your? Because you've said the Supreme Court is really the only recourse.
No, that's correct. We can only appeal to the Supreme Court. When it's a state versus state issue, we can't file in a district court. We can't file in a state court. We would be dismissed immediately. We would never get a hearing. Under the Constitution, if you're suing another state, the only place that you can go is to the U.S. Supreme Court, which is why I think they should have to hear these cases. And some of the justices, I think a few of them actually believe that it is required. Others have viewed this as discretionary. Either way, they ought to at least hear this case. We have no other way to redress harms to Texas voters who were disenfranchised by the illegitimate votes in other states. And if our case is not heard by the U.S. Supreme Court, then we don't get heard anywhere. And that is not the way the judicial system is supposed to work.
Do you think that there would be a precedent established for future elections where if, you know, say, for instance, one state wants to have voter ID, but another state doesn't, and say, like, you know, California or New York decides to challenge Texas because of our photo ID and say we're disenfranchising voters? I mean, is that something that you're concerned about?
No, I mean, they could always challenge. I mean, the whole point of being able to go to court is the founders didn't want us to have to go fight each other with guns. So the appropriate place to ask is the court. If you have a legitimate issue, you're supposed to take it to the court. So, yeah, I think New York would have that opportunity to bring the case, but it might be dismissed out of hand if it wasn't a legitimate case. And so this is our system of government. We don't go shoot each other. We don't use guns. We don't use force. We go and we have a civil discussion, a civil debate, and an argument in front of judges. And they tell us, hey, this is what the Constitution means, and this is what you have to do.
Right, right. We're talking with Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton. One of the issues that I've seen raised, not a lot, but frequently enough, and interestingly, I've seen it come from the right more than the left, is the issue of the Solicitor General. You know, the individual that would usually present cases for Texas in front of the Supreme Court. That individual was not, from what I understand, not party to this brief. What is the reasoning, or what is the story with that?
So, you know, we all have different opinions, and ultimately it's up to me to decide. And so I decided we were going forward, and, you know, I signed these briefs as well. And I signed this one, and I signed it proudly. And my job is not to represent, you know, some small group of people in Texas or somebody, just the lawyers in Texas that have certain views on the Constitution. My job is to represent all Texans. And so I felt like in this case, I had to go forward with this lawsuit because so all of my voters, in my view, were disenfranchised by what happened in these other states.
Yeah, and the issue of mail-in ballots, I feel like that's, I mean, we've been talking about that all week. I feel like that's a discussion, that's a case that, that's a fight that's going to be litigated, I think, in state by state. Now, you know, for the elephant in the room, a lot of critics out there, and we're talking with the Attorney General of Texas, Ken Paxton, who filed this suit on behalf of Texas voters about the election. A lot, there's, you know, obviously you see what is said out there, and I don't trust anything that I read in the media. I have to look it up and run things down myself. But there are a lot of people that are criticizing you on the suit. They say it's a Hail Mary suit. And some on the left are saying, well, this is just the Attorney General. He's trying to curry favor with an outgoing president because of the ongoing investigation in which you're involved. And how do you address those accusations of people who say that this is just trying to get a pardon from, you know, the outgoing President Trump with this lawsuit? How do you address that?
So what I would say is, look, I've been fighting voter fraud since I've been in office. We have had serious litigation related to mail-in ballots and signature verification and numerous other election issues over the last year. You can go look up the court proceedings. We've been doing this for almost a year. We've spent hundreds and hundreds of hours fighting these lawsuits. And so why would it be unusual that I would continue to be involved in the very same issues I've been involved with heavily for the last year? And really, for my entire time in office, I've focused on voter integrity and making sure that Texas election laws are followed. So it's ludicrous to say that suddenly I've changed my views. It's exactly what I've been doing for the last 6 years in office as Attorney General.
What happens if the Supreme Court declines to hear the case? And I know this is something that I think they're going to announce this at any point now. What's after that?
We have no step. That means that Texas, if my voters suffered harm, they don't have the opportunity to present that harm to any judge anywhere in the country, I guess, ever, because the court has said, no, we're not going to take it for whatever reason. They don't have to have a reason. And I actually think the better jurisprudence, I actually think, and as I said earlier, I think some of the justices believe this is true, that the court has to hear our case because we don't have another place. And the way our judicial system works is you're supposed to have a place to file and be heard at least once. And after that, you know, it's up to courts of appeals. But in this case, that would mean the court would say, look, we're sorry, you may have had tremendous harm, but we're just not going to hear it, and we have nowhere to go. That's a problem.
Does it matter when with this particular case, like for instance, I know because I was looking at the brief, some of the things that were mentioned, just to throw out one example, like Pennsylvania, or there, I know that there were some things in Michigan and Wisconsin referenced. If those states have declined to pursue those legally, if how it, is it just like you start over with a clean slate? Because there are some who say that, well, because the states declined these cases, that somehow renders the examples that you list in the brief substantiating, you know, the validity of this argument, that renders it moot. I mean, it pretty much undermines it.
No, I think we have our own case, and it's built around some of the same facts, but not all of the same facts. And it's also based on a different argument, which is a constitutional argument. And we have the right to make that argument in Texas, and we have the right to make it because this is a federal election that affects every single person in this country. And if we don't get this right this time, how are we going to have confidence in the future of our elections going forward? It undermines people's confidence. And that's what we're trying to restore, is not just confidence in this election, but confidence going forward, so that people believe that their vote matters.
Yeah, and that's the big question right now. People don't have a lot of faith in their systems. I mean, I was just telling you, just as before I introduced you, I received a voter registration certificate from someone who's never lived at my house, and I have to go take it up now with the County Board of Elections because we think they fraudulently voted from my address. So that's and it's common. And I mean, if it happens to me, it happens to a lot of other people. It just doesn't, you know, get mentioned on national airwaves.
Look, we know that fraud is going on, but what I saw this time, and I saw it coming because we were dealing with it in Texas, as I said, for the last year in litigation after, you know, litigation after litigation, that we had more litigation over, you know, voting than we've ever had, probably, you know, combined. And what I saw was a strategy nationally by the Democratic Party to do these, because of COVID, supposedly, it was cover for doing mail-in ballots, which, as you know, have a much higher degree of fraud because we don't have photo ID tied to it. And then on top of that, when you have states invalidating the signature verification so that we can't match signatures, it's a total, you know, who knows? We could have had 2.5 million illegitimate ballots in Pennsylvania or two. There's no, they set it up. It was a great strategy if you wanted to cover up a fraud, but we'll never know because they fixed it in a way that you can't know.
It's like death by a thousand cuts in some respects. Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton, we appreciate your time today. And we'll be watching to see what the Supreme Court decides and where to go from there.
Well, let's pray that they hear it, because this is really important for the future of the country. And if our Supreme Court won't give us an answer, then I think they're not doing their job. And I think it hurts the nation going forward.
It's a heavy time. It definitely is. Good to see you, sir. Thank you so much. Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton.